Coming up next, round six of AMS Oil Championship Snocross from Minneapolis. A massive extreme track and an Arctic blast present a big-time challenge. Strap in! The world's greatest snowcross racers are ready to get it on the CBS Sports Network. Welcome to Minneapolis, Minnesota, the beautiful city. We are just miles away from there at Canterbury Park in Shakopee, Minnesota for round six of AMS Oil Championship Snowcross powered by Ram. The Pertec Snowcross Nationals presented by Jimmy John's. A great racetrack. My name is Chris Hockey here with Mike Schroeder, Carly Applin here as well. About to bring you coverage of round six of what has been a fantastic season so far. Let's go back to round five though and show you exactly what happened and how we got here.
Shot does go to Tucker Hibbert, and he takes the lead away from Logan Christian on the outside. The T-train to the lead. It's the one thing you can't have happen is the one thing that's happening right now. Tucker Hibbert is shot out of a cannon, and he's running away to hide. Battle for second. The 43 is Logan Christian. Dribbling to the inside. He'll try to make a move early. He won't make it there, but he is hunting down the second spot right now. The nine-time champion, your points leader coming into tonight over the AMSOIL finish line. Nine laps to go for the T-Train. The man out of Pelican Rapids, Minnesota for Monster Energy, Arctic Cat, and Ram Truck. He has been dominant, the most dominant rider of his generation, and that continues here tonight at Canterbury Park. The laps continue to tick away.
Windheim!
He found it! He made the pass! The 311 into third! The Jimmy John sled over the AMS Oil finish line into third place!
And not even close tonight. With three laps to go, Tucker Hibbert has about a 12-second lead on the entire field. Each week comes out with the perfect setup for each track. Tucker Hibbert and his entire team has every sled dialed in. Tonight, it's been impressive. Down the stretch, he comes for the final time. The checkers in the air for the nine-time champion. Tucker Hibbert has done it again at Canterbury Park.
So there you have it. More of the same from the T-Train, Tucker Hibbert, Mike.
You know, that win gives him more points, puts a little bit more ahead of Cody Cam. We talk about injuries and the way some of these guys are getting banged up. They're going to need to stay with Tucker. You know, we're almost halfway through the season. They don't want to let him get too far away.
Yeah, you know, these racers are in peak condition, and they have to be to continue to compete on these giant sleds on tracks like this. And Carly Applin explored that a little bit more down in the trailers earlier.
I'm in the Layton Motorsports trailer with Corin Todd. Unique to something you do on the course is wear a heart monitor. Talk about why you do that.
I wear a heart rate monitor basically to just monitor my body function and stuff like that, see where I'm at on the track as far as where my training has brought me and stuff like that all summer. It's good to know we can take the information that we gather from the heart rate monitor during the racing and try to replicate that during the week for our training and in the off season all summer. But a lot of times average is 185, 190, and that's probably pretty solid for most guys.
Has anybody said that is dangerously high, Corin Todd?
Some people have said that. Yeah, I don't know. Probably 220 is scary, I'm sure. But, you know, probably if you're hitting 220, your adrenaline is going through the roof and, you know, you probably made a big mistake and wrecked or did something foolish.
Are you planning on wearing this tonight during the race?
Yeah, I might. It'd be good to see. It's a big track, pretty rough last night. So, yeah, it'd be good to see where we're at.
Well, good luck out there tonight.
Thank you.
Guys.
Wow, and that's an accelerated heart rate, no doubt about it. Speaking of accelerating, the Pro Light division in round five was very exciting. Let's take a look at what happened.
They are racing in Shakopee. Into turn one they go. Oh my goodness, it's a battle for the lead. The 177 of Angove, I don't even think he knew Elias was right there, and now he certainly does, as he had a shoulder full over him, of him over the AMS Oil finish line.
Oh no!
Elias's sled has broken! Your leader's sled has stopped in the middle of the racetrack. So Jake Angle says, thank you, I'm out of here. The 177 has a big lead right now in this Pro Light Open. Thanks to a malfunction of that sled, Kern has started to reel in the leader just a little bit right there. A much faster lap, almost a half a second faster on that lap, was Travis Kern than your leader, Jake Angle. Angle checks up again. Here comes Travis Kern. Things are about to get interesting in Shakopee. Angove has got to start hoping that Kern and Wallenstein start to battle. If that happens, then maybe he can get away and get a little bit comfortable. Out of the Makita corner and headed towards the Amsoil finish line. The white flag is in the air. One lap left for Jake Angove. He's been leading since the beginning of this race. Can he hang on for another lap? Out of the Makita final corner and headed for the checkers for a win in Shakopee. Jake Angove will win the Pro Light Division at Canterbury Park.
So that leads us to this. Here's how it looks in the points.
Tightened up. Montana Jesse said needed to be solid and just be consistent. But there's some people really starting to push him now in this Pro Light point standings. It's going to be interesting racing all season long.
Yeah, I can't wait any longer. Let's get started right after this short break. The first Pro Open qualifier will begin. There's a shot of the racetrack. It's Canterbury Park in Shakopee, Minnesota. This is AMSOIL Championship Snowcross, powered by Ram. We'll be right back on the CBS Sports Network.
AMSOIL Championship Snowcross on CBS Sports Network is being brought to you by Ram. Guts, glory, Ram. By GoPro, be a hero. And by Arctic Cat, share our passion.
And welcome back to Canterbury Park in Shakopee, Minnesota for round six of AMSOIL Championship Snowcross, powered by Ram. The best show on the snow in front of a great crowd. The Pertec Snowcross National presented by Jimmy Johns on a spectacular racetrack. Let's take our GoPro lap of the day, Mike.
And it's a cold racetrack too. Air temperature -2. Wind temperature -21. These drivers out there, very cold. You get in that roost. You go through the first part of the racetrack. You see the rhythm section there across the AMSOIL finish line. Now watch this. It goes big as you go down into that Ram turn and another big fly away there. Now you're in the FXR corner. This has collected a lot of drivers. You have a couple of lines to take, and you have a choice to make here before you go into the back part of the racetrack. This now leads you into the U.S. Air Force flyaway.
And this is where things get serious. Look at this big air over the triples, then a set of doubles, another set of doubles into the Polaris turn. This is a very, very tricky part of the track. A rhythm section, a hard left-hander, and you're at the very back of the racetrack, Mike.
Now, this is where you need to set up. If you've got a chance to make a pass on someone to try to get underneath them or be on the outside, there's a couple of lines. But after you come out of this big sweeping turn, you're back on the front straight, and then you lay on that power and hope you can make your pass before the AMSOIL finish line.
You've seen the racetrack, now let's see the racing. Here's the Pro Open qualifier lineup.
Andy Leaders racing, taking Ross Martin's spot after Ross is, of course, injured again. You see Trevor Layton, Petter Narsa, and, of course, Ryan Springer.
The Pertec Snowcross National presented by Jimmy Johns. Qualifier number one for the AMSOIL Pro Open is on the starting line here at Canterbury. It's in the starter's hands. The snow is about to fly. And we are racing at Canterbury. Oh, somebody off their sled. That might have been Andy Leaders. No, I guess it wasn't. That's the 54 out front. That's Petter Narsa.
Narsa, then going along with Narsa is Justin Brobert, Kyle Boleyn there. I asked Kyle what happened to him in round five. He said he just got cut off of the finish line flyaway. Right now, he's charging hard to try and move up front.
He certainly is. Dives inside, takes second place. Kyle Polite is on the move, but the man out front is Petter Narsa. Had a bit of a coming out party last night, and he is fast tonight. They're tripling that Air Force flyaway. Look to the outside. Who's that on that black sled coming up
that
there?
That would be Brobert. So Brobert just ahead of Adam Renheim. Renheim now has moved up into fourth place, and Renheim on the podium in round number five.
The man out front, though, is Petter Narsa. Let's look at how he got out there. The start, as you see, on the right-hand side of the street, that was Ryan Springer that came off the sled right there.
Didn't take long for Peter Narsa to get out front, and he is still there. Big air into turn one here at Canterbury Park. The track is significantly different here in round six, and we're seeing big air tonight.
One of the things that the driver talked about, and I asked him this afternoon between round six tonight and round five, is that it got cold, and so a lot of the snow underneath got icy, and it's fluffy on top, so there's a lot of ice ridges underneath that they need to be very careful of.
Great racing happening here. That's Kyle Pauline and Justin Broberg battling for the second place spot. Or is that John Stenberg?
No, that's John Stenberg. Stenberg on the skidoo.
Look at this. A three abreast, two abreast, racing through the backstretch into that Makita corner, and down the stretch they come over the Amsoil finish line. It's Peter Narsa. It's Kyle Pauline and Adam Renheim. Stenberg right there as well.
He may be a lap sled. He may have been the one of the drivers that got tied up in that incident early on. We're scoring Kyle Pauline is second, Adam Renheim third, and that's the way we've seen them. So we'll go by that. But Narsa, we know, out in front.
We have some exciting stuff on tap tonight with a track like this. Big air all over this place. And speaking of down by the racetrack, that's where Carly Applin is right now. Carly.
With the cold temperatures tonight, it's a much different race for these guys. You watch as they come behind me, the snow dust flying through the air. It's going to affect visibility, and that soft, sugary snow also going to affect traction on this track for these guys tonight. They're going to have to learn to adapt.
Adapting to it right now, there's Kyle Pauline. He currently scored in third place on the 324. In round five, a significantly disappointing race for him, right now performing at a top level. But there is your leader. Oh, no! Almost loses it, does your leader. He somehow saves it, and down the backstretch over the Air Force Flyaway, he will triple that. But was that slip up enough to let everybody get back to him? We'll find out. That is John Stenberg, by the way, in second on the 259.
Scoring is squared away here, so Stenberg looking very strong on that Warner Brother Makita skidoo. Narsa still with a nice run here.
A 48-second lap for your leader on that last time around. Two laps left as he crosses the Amsoil finish line. Last night, Peter Narsa did enough to get him to fifth in the points. Tonight, in this, the first Pro Open qualifier, he has got it nailed down, and he is your leader.
And about a four-second differential between those drivers as they work their way through the back part of the racetrack. They'll transition, come back in, and then they will take and work through the back part of the racetrack.
I don't mean to disagree, but I believe Stenberg has reeled him in. That's not quite a four-second lead anymore. It looks like about a second at the most. Right now, Stenberg a little bit faster than Peter Narsa. This could get hairy in this last lap and a half.
Narsa sweeps that far corner. This is where they really try to position themselves so they can use all of the speed of the sled to carry themselves to the front part of the racetrack. You see how he launched a little bit wider because of the speed. Not a problem. One lap left to go and about a second and a half lead.
Big air by that big Ram truck as they head into the FXR turn for the final time in this Pro Open qualifier. It's Narsa, it's Stenberg on your screen right now.
Boy, they all stay out of that hole in the FXR corner, and they stay away from the kicker in the transition into the back. Now they head into the U.S. Air Force Flyaway.
Oh, a bit of a bobble for Narsa, and here comes Stenberg. Half a lap to go. Stenberg looks to the inside. Can't make the move there. Does he have enough race left?
Stenberg probably should be looking inside here. Just try to rail and square to come into this last part of the racetrack. Just like that, comes through that last corner. He's got to stay tight. I don't think he's going to be able to do it.
Peter Narsa down the stretch and over the Amsoil finish line for the win in this Pro Open qualifier at Canterbury Park. Great race for Peter Narsa, and Stenberg gave him everything he could. We'll take a break. We'll come back and talk to our winner right after this. This is Amsoil Championship Snowcross powered by Ram. It's the Pertex Snowcross National presented by Jimmy Johns on the CBS Sports Network. And we are racing at Canterbury. Oh, somebody off their sled. That might have been Andy Leaders. No, I guess it wasn't. A bit of a bobble for Narsa, and here comes Stenberg. Half a lap to go. Stenberg looks to the inside. Can't make the move there. Does he have enough race left? Peter Narsa down the stretch and over the Amsoil finish line for the win in this Pro Open qualifier at Canterbury Park.
Peter, congratulations on that win. These cold temperatures, how are they affecting you and the track conditions?
For sure, it's changing the track a lot. I mean, it's sugar snow out there and a lot of ice too. My hands are kind of cold.
How, you know, having Cody Cam, your teammate, injured, is that more pressure on you out there?
Injured, I don't know. He'll be good today, I think.
We're excited to see him back out there. Good luck tonight.
Thank you.
Guys.
I do believe our winner's lips were frozen during that interview. Exciting Pro Open qualifier and a great run for Peter Narsa.
Narsa starting off where he left off from round five, winning the heat. Good to see John Stenberg, Kyle Kleen in third, and there you see the rest of the drivers, how they finish in that Pro Open qualifier.
Peter Narsa, great run. Cold night, but a great night for racing. Coming up next on the CBS Sports Network, the Pro Light feature. Stick around. This is AMSOIL Championship Snowcross, powered by Ram. Welcome back to Minneapolis, Minnesota. Just down the road from there, Canterbury Park in Shakopee, Minnesota. It's round six of AMSOIL Championship Snowcross, powered by Ram. The Pertec Snowcross National, presented by Jimmy Johns. I've got Mike Schroeder. My name is Chris Hockey, and we are ready to go racing with our AMSOIL Pro Light Final. Mike, let's look at this back row and front row.
You know what? James Johnstead, round five, got landed on, came into round six, won both his heats, the number one qualifier. Katu, that's big, and look at Elias Ischel.
In fourth right there on the front row, but a back row just stacked, Mike.
Montana Jess, he was a points leader, had to come through the LCQ. Brady Love, Nastalia Patton, and George.
It's in the starter's hands, and we are racing at Canterbury Park. Down the hill into the first turn they go.
Everybody launches off, and is that Daniel Benham? It is Daniel Benham, and look who's alongside of him. That is Johnstead. So Benham, Johnstead, and then a battle. That's Travis Kern slotting in there on that 201 Arnie Cat.
The stud boy hole shot goes to Daniel Benham, but he's got to get away from that pack behind him, and that's going to be nothing easy right there. Benham to the outside. Inside is Johnstead. Down the back stretch they go, and over the Air Force flyaway.
Boy, Johnstead a little rough through that turn, able to square it up, and I'll tell you what, behind them, it is just mayhem. They are three and four abreast.
Oh!
Into the corner.
Big crash. I believe that was Wallenstein right there. That's
and
the 201 of Travis Kern.
Yep.
Kern had had such a great evening. It's sad to see that.
And
meanwhile,
they were
out front,
running three and four, but out front, it is still Benham and then Johnstead. Now, Johnstead looks like he's got company, and it's probably his teammate, Cole Katu.
Let's set the field. It's Daniel Benham, James Johnstead, and Montana Jess in third. Here's what happened, Mike.
Watch them as they come into the corner. I said three abreast. Just everybody looking for the same piece of real estate. Also involved in that, Maxine Taillefer. It was just a carnage down there like you wouldn't believe.
And I'll tell you, that was a pretty aggressive move by, I believe, Montana Jess in that turn. But on the racetrack and still out front is the 221 of Daniel Benham. Daniel Benham from Deer River, Minnesota. Arctic Cat, Benham Electrics, and Speedworks bring him to the racetrack, and right now he's representing them well.
Johnstead sitting in second spot.
Oh, hang on to it. Whoa, the leader almost lost the sled right there.
And then Montana Jess sitting in third. So, you know, you're aggressive, and it paid off for him. But he's got to watch behind him, because I'll tell you what, the number 200 Skidoo, Elias Ischel, sitting there in fourth place.
Yeah, he is not done determining what this race is going to be like. The 200 is Elias Ischel, and he has been fast at every racetrack. A lot of times, it's checkers or wreckers for that man. You pointed it out earlier today. He seems to be a little calmer this year. Let's see if he's calm enough to work his way to the front. That's the battle for third on your screen right now.
You know, the thing to remember right now, Elias sitting trying to make the pass. You know, he's got seven laps left. Just take and make sure that you're clean and clear, that you get around him, and then work on the next person. You make one pass here, it's going to put you on the podium.
He's only 17 years old. Oh, there's the battle for second starting to heat up. Second, third, and fourth on your screen right there. The 14 is Johnstead. The 765 is Jess. And there's Elias Ischel as they head over the big triples and into the Dodge turn.
Johnstead goes to the outside. Jess is on the inside. Look at Ischel.
Oh,
Ischel going to go underneath
there,
and get
him. He takes that one spot.
Nope, got the one spot.
So now it's Jess, it's Ischel, and it's James Johnson. Something's wrong with Johnson. There goes Ischel. Wow. Elias Ischel in the second. And Johnson says, where'd he come from? And now he sets his sight on the leader. Does he have enough time to get into the lead? We're about to find out, Mike.
Yeah, he sure are.
Let's go down to Carly Applin right at the side of the racetrack.
An adjustment made to the track was a 15-foot jump. This is a spot where the racers can take advantage if they decide to not just single it, but double it. They can get 20 feet of air and even 75 feet of distance. Again, a spot where they can gain ground on the other riders. Back to you.
To the outside goes Elias Ischel. He gets, oh my goodness, he gets the lead, but he almost loses a sled.
He did, and you know, that was a little of the old Elias there, just really, really aggressive going through the corner. Just about lost it, but yet makes the pass. He's out front on that Makita Skidoo.
Oh, he's off the track. Elias Ischel, it's checkers or wreckers for that young man. And that time, it was almost wreckers. He's back on the track.
And where did he slot back in? Right alongside of Daniel Benham,
now,
the leader.
This is going to be interesting. He didn't advance. And he's off his sled.
He's off.
Elias Ischel off his sled while running second. He's trying to get it righted. And back to the lead goes the 221 of Daniel Benham. Here's what happened, Mike.
Watch him here as he goes in. He lands off camber just a little bit, can't get his feet repositioned, and he loses control of the sled. Off it goes from the racetrack, but he doesn't tip over. He gets back on and then has another issue.
Wow, that's all you can say. Daniel Benham will retake the lead and say thank you. That puts Montana Jess into second and Cole Cattu into third. Let's see what happened on that second and what turned out to be the worst of the two crashes.
And tried to come inside. Oh, man, just, you know, didn't get a transfer of his weight the way it needed to be and had too much drive on the left-hand side and over the sled went.
Let's take a deep breath. Let me set the lineup one more time for you. That man is your leader. That's Daniel Benham on the 221. Right behind him on the screen is Montana Jess. They're heading for the Amsoil finish line. Let's set the entire field for you here. Benham, then Montana Jess, and in third right now coming across will be Cole Cattu. That's 1, 2, 3 if it were to finish like this, but this race is far from over. Three laps to go for Daniel Benham. Into the GoPro corner, and now down the back stretch he goes over the Air Force flyaway right here.
Well, he's just trying to be patient as he goes around here. He knows that, you know, this race is his to win, trying not to make any mistakes. He's got about a 2-second lead over Montana Jess. We're counting down laps.
When he comes around here, he'll come out of this Makita corner and head for the Amsoil finish line. They'll give him the signal that he's got two laps to go. He's going to be two laps away from the trophy here at Canterbury, a very hard-fought victory. Going back to the Elias Ischel accident, I can't help but think that he might have worn himself out a bit or thrown himself off a bit on that first incident when he went off the track, and by the time he lost the center of his weight over there in the corner, it was too much for him.
Well, not only physically, but mentally. I mean, you start thinking about the mental mistakes that you made on the racetrack, and then all of a sudden it just compounds itself and you have bigger mental mistakes, and I think that's probably one of the big things that happened to Elias.
Less than two laps to go for Daniel Benham. Behind him, Montana Jess is on the gas and doing everything he can to try to reel in the leader, but the laps and the time is ticking away for him to catch Daniel Benham.
Benham goes through that far corner, again sweeping around. He's got about a lap and a quarter left. All he's got is about another 70, 75 seconds left on this racetrack, and this race is his.
Over the Amsoil finish line, one lap to go for Daniel Benham, and if he can hold on, he will take this checkered flag here at Canterbury Park. Montana Jess on your screen just for a second, charging hard to try to reel in the leader. It continues to be Cole Cattu in third and James Johnstead in fourth, but that is your leader. A quick look over the shoulder for Montana Jess. There he is over the Air Force flyaway. Daniel Benham in the front on the 221.
Just be clean here. Think what you're doing.
Less than half a lap to go. Through the Polaris turn clean on the very back section of the racetrack for the final time. Two turns away from victory for Daniel Benham.
Boy, that corner's starting to get chewed up. You're getting these finals. There you see, it's just rutted out.
into the Makita corner for the final time, and down the stretch he comes. The pride of Deer River, Minnesota has done it. Checkers in the air and the win for Daniel Benham here at Canterbury Park. Montana Jess will come across in second and Cole Coutu in third. Let's take a quick break, catch our breath, and come back and talk to our winner. The winner once again of the Pro Light Division here at Canterbury Park was Daniel Benham. This is AMS World Championship Snowcross powered by Ram on the CBS Sports Network. We are racing at Canterbury Park. Down the hill into the first turn they go. To the outside goes Elias Ischel. He gets, oh my goodness, he gets the lead, but he almost loses a sled.
Front on that Makita Skidoo.
He's off the track. This is going to be interesting. He didn't advance. He's off his sled.
He's off.
Into the Makita corner for the final time, and down the stretch he comes. The pride of Deer River, Minnesota has done it. Checkers in the air and the win for Daniel Benham.
Daniel, you said it's been a little bit of a rough season for you, so you were really ready for this first place.
Yeah, for sure. You know, I've had a couple good runs and a couple not so good. Last weekend in Fargo, I was leading and crashed. So, you know, I knew Elias was coming, and he got by me, and I just tried to ride my solid lines, you know, and try not to make any mistakes. Sure enough, he made a mistake. And I guess, you know, that's just how it goes, and I was lucky to capitalize.
Again, congratulations.
Thank you.
Guys.
This class never disappoints, Mike. The Pro Light Final, Daniel Benham with a big win.
Elias Ischel was up battling early on and had that off. That allowed Daniel Benham to move on for the win. Cole Coutu making the podium. That's his first podium as a Pro Light rider. There you see the rest of them, the way they finished up in the final.
A great race, and that simply leads you to the last race of the night here in round six. The AMSOIL Pro Open is final, and it is coming up next. AMSOIL Championship Snowcross, powered by Ram. We'll be right back on the CBS Sports Network.
AMSOIL Championship Snowcross on CBS Sports Network is being brought to you by Polaris. Terrain domination. By FXR, world-class outwear. And by AMSOIL, the first instant.
The beautiful skyline of Minneapolis, Minnesota. Welcome back to AMSOIL Championship Snowcross, powered by Ram. Round six from Canterbury Park in Shakopee, Minnesota, the Pertec Snowcross National, presented by Jimmy Johns. My name is Chris Hockey. We've got Mike Schroeder here as well, and Carly Applin joining us in front of a record crowd. Mike, what a great racetrack. We've seen great races here before, but not quite much like we saw last year.
There's been some great historic moments in racing right here, but last year was a classic.
And Tremblay trying to get in that battle too, but here comes the boss. The boss on the outside.
Pauline and Ross Martin into the turn. Pauline will take it out as they head for the FXR turn, and down the short chute they go. Kyle Pauline into the final turn for the final time and headed towards the AMSOIL finish line. The flames in the air for Kyle Pauline. Kyle Pauline has won the AMSOIL Championship Snowcross powered by Ram. Pertec Nationals presented by Jimmy Johns.
That footage still makes me smile, Mike. Kyle Pauline earned his nickname Senior Smiley that night. Levi Lavalle was in the booth with us and just so very excited. Excitement is the key, though. When it comes to this racetrack, we always see something special, don't we?
Of course, especially when it's your first Pro Open win. It was extremely exciting for not only Kyle Pauline, his entire team.
Well, there you go. We've reminded you how good the racing can be. Let's go racing again. Here's the starting lineup for tonight's Pro Open Final.
Take a look at this. Front row, Tim Tremblay, Cody Kamm, Stenberg. The name that you don't see in there, of course, Tucker Hibbert had to come through the LCQ. He'll be in the back row.
Yeah, let's take a look at that back row. You'll see it. Tucker Hibbert's right there. Adam Renheim as well. Trevor Layton. It's an action-packed group of racers ready to go green here in a couple of moments. Let's go down to Carly Applin. She's right by the starting line.
Guys, we know that Cody Kamm leaves nothing on the track. Nate Hench's team owner of Hench's Racing announcing today that Cody Kamm has suffered from a pulled groin. He was racing on it in Fargo, came out in the last round, had to pull off the track in the final. Tonight, he comes in qualifying number two on the start line. We hope he can make it through all of this final. We'll wait and see. Back to you.
People getting on their sleds, getting things cleared out of the way. We are about to go green. It's in the starters' hands at Canterbury Park. Up at the top of the hill.
are racing at Shakopee. 15 slams into the turn. Down the stretch they go, and Peter Narsa with the stud boy hole shot. It's the teammates from Hinches Racing out front into the ram turn. Peter Narsa, Cody Kam take the lead. And Cody goes around the teammate and into the lead.
Boy, and they're bunching up down in the corner. You know, we talked about Hibbert in the back row. He had a good line, worked his way through, and looks like he's going to slot himself into fifth or sixth spot. So he's all right. You know, if you're a Tucker Hibbert fan, sitting in sixth spot early on with 13 laps left to go.
But the man you don't want out front, if you're Tucker Hibbert, is the man out front. That's Cody Kam. Injury and all, he is out front and leading this race at Canterbury Park.
And not only him, but we've seen brilliance from his teammate also. Narsa was on the podium in round five. Can he do it again tonight?
Let's take a look at that start and see how Cody Kam and Peter Narsa got out front, Mike.
Watch him as they launch right in the middle there. He just cuts hard up front, and you know, they were clean, they were both clean.
This is Tucker's view from the start.
A little ISO, look at him eat all that ruse.
Look at that, you can't see anything.
But you know, the thing was, like I said, he stayed inside, so he had clean racing, nobody got tangled up in front of him. It's a good break for him.
Tucker Hibbert's in fifth, chasing those two, the teammates, 53 and 54. The man out front is injured, almost you'd say severely, a groin issue for the 53 of Cody Kam, but he is leading this race right now by a second and a half over his teammate, Peter Narsa.
Boy, and he looks solid. He's just driven tonight. Watch him as he comes across to complete another lap. There he is, Kam, then it's Narsa, Lemieux right behind them.
I love that.
And then Tucker Hibbert now by John Stenberg for fourth place.
Up to fourth place is the T-Train. Tucker Hibbert, Lincoln Lemieux in his sights. He'll look to the inside to try to get around the 13 sled. Can't make the move there. He follows him into that FXR turn, and down the stretch they go. It's Lemieux and Tucker. The battle for third begins to rage.
Boy, and you can see because of the cold how this snow dust starting to hang. 14 laps. It is going to be difficult to see the further into this race we go in certain parts of the racetrack.
Tucker looks to the inside of Lincoln Lemieux. It's a hard move for Tucker, and he takes the spot. Tucker Hibbert up to third spot from the back row, and now only two people separate him from another win here at Canterbury Park. Cody Kam and Peter Narsa try to run away and hide.
Narsa is about 3 seconds behind Kam. Tucker another 3 seconds there. So Tucker's got about 6 seconds to get himself back up to Cody Kam.
Carly Applin's down beside the racetrack. Carly, what do you see?
You guys, you can't underestimate these right-hand turns. We don't see very many of them when we're on the iSoc tour throughout the year. Robbie Malinowski, former racer and also crew chief for Layton Motorsports, said it is so unnatural for these riders to take a right-hand turn. The throttle ends up in their stomach, and they really slow down and look like a fish out of water. So they can gain advantage if they can get through that right-hand turn. Two riders who train on a track with right-hand turns, Logan Christian and Tucker Hibbert. Guys?
And right now, Tucker Hibbert is in third, chasing that man, Cody Kam. There's Tucker. Cody Kam right now with a 2.5 second lead or so over Tucker Hibbert. It's Cody Kam. It's Peter Narsa. It's Tucker Hibbert with 9 to go, Mike.
Kam runs a 48.2, his teammate a 48.4. Tucker Hibbert running a 47.8, so about a half second faster than the two Polaris's up front.
The question is, Mike, does the groin injury start to bother Cody as the race gets longer and the laps continue to be clicked off? Does the endurance become a problem for Cody, do you think?
It very well could be, but I'll tell you what, when you're out in front, sometimes you may not feel that pain knowing that you've got a win that was in your grasp.
Down the stretch he goes. Another lap is in the books for Cody Kam. We've got 8 laps to go for the 53. It continues to be Peter Narsa in second, and there's Tucker Hibbert. Tucker will look to the outside as he tries to make up room on second and first.
Narsa.
A great shot at the FXR turn there.
Right, Narsa going to the outside. Tucker following him around. Not close enough to make the move, but he has made up some ground on Peter Narsa.
Over the the Air Force flyaway, you see a great shot as Tucker has begun to reel in second spot. Peter Narsa doing all he can to stay in front of the T-Train.
He looks to the inside. He was almost there. He just about got a ski underneath him in that corner.
Tucker is absolutely known to be patient when he's got to be, but the laps are ticking off.
They are. We continue. There's seven laps left to go.
Second and third on your screen. Peter Narsa out front on the 54 of the 68 of Tucker Hibbert.
See if he can set him up here. This is where he's tried it a couple times. Oh, oh, Tucker having a problem there,
no,
but
he just cased it hard, and it didn't slow him down a bit. Wow, Tucker Hibbert, a strong move and into second of the C-train. But here comes Peter Narsa. Can he or can he not reel him back in? A hard landing for the T-train, and Cody Kam is the only man left in front of him for now.
And that corner there, Narsa was thinking about trying to go down low, but unfortunately, that corner's only developed into one line. There's no other way to get around that part of the racetrack.
We've continued to watch that battle. Let's see how it happened. Tucker Hibbert got into second by doing this. A hard move inside Peter Narsa, very clean, and he's in second place. But there's six laps to go to try to catch that man. The 53 of Cody Kam from Kenosha, Wisconsin. The lead is almost 6 seconds. Is it enough?
Cody, you can be sure they're putting out on his lap board what he's got. They're just telling him to be patient, to breathe, and make your way as he's getting close to lappers and to work his way around this racetrack. Right ahead of him, that of course, the number three, that's the sledded Trevor Layton, as he will try to get around him and put Layton between him and a Tucker. Now Layton, another Polaris driver, and we don't see Tucker in the shot yet. There's Tucker just coming out of the corner.
Five laps to go, Mike.
Let's see what the difference is.
5 laps to go for Cody Kam. Into your screen comes Tucker Hibbert. You see it right there. The lead is 4.8 seconds now.
Not a lot of difference. Cody ran a 49.4, a 48.3. About 6, 7 tenths of a second he shaved off.
And he's got to keep moving. He still has Trevor Layton between himself and Tucker Hibbert. But Tucker is coming up on Trevor right now, looking to dispatch of him right now. That is a passable lapper for the T-train.
Yeah,
he makes it easy.
Trevor giving him the room he needed to get by. Very professional. Didn't try to block him or anything. So now T-train still, once again, there's no sledge between him and Cody Kam. And they'll come by and we'll set him up one more time as we start counting down laps.
4 laps to go for Cody Kam. He's got a groin injury that's been hampering him all weekend long. But here we are in round 6, and Cody Kam has a 5-second lead on Tucker Hibbert.
Able to extend it just a bit. Cody ran a 48.2 to a 48.4. So he was 2 seconds faster that lap than Tucker. They're running just about identical lap times. And that's good for Cody Kam.
Cody looks fantastic into that Polaris turn through the back section of the track, just running his own line. Watching Tucker behind him a bit, it looks like they're running identical lines, and that again is good for Cody Kam. Smooth into that Makita turn is Cody Kam. He'll make the turn and head down the front stretch towards the Amsoil finish line. He crosses that finish line. We'll tell you what the difference is in just a moment. Cody Kam is in the lead. Here comes the T-train.
Boy, and it's a little bit more, another tenth that he's added to it, so he's a little faster.
Again.
Oh, and
what happened?
That, I think your leader's off the racetrack. He is.
Cody Kam is off the racetrack. We were watching Tucker Hibbert, who's now your leader, and Cody Kam went off the track. Cody right there in the ramp turn. Oh no.
He was over too far, cased it.
Cody Kam hard off the racetrack. Grabs his leg immediately, and that was the injured leg he grabs. Hopefully he's all right. He's still down over there, and Tucker Hibbert has taken the lead. We talked about patience. We talked about Tucker Hibbert always sitting back, and right now he has been given the gift of a lead.
And that's another thing we talked about, is luck in racing. Cody Kam, this was his race to win, with a 5-second lead, had an issue.
There's Cody right there. Back on the sled very gingerly. Hopefully he didn't re-aggravate the injury any worse. But Tucker Hibbert assumes the lead. He's a 9-time and defending champion in this sport. And he is right now 2 laps away from another win at Canterbury Park.
And now he's in the same position that he was last night. Out in front, 9-second lead. Doesn't need to push it. Knows exactly where the other racers are on the racetrack. Wow.
A giant development, and the T train is at it again. The 68 headed for the Amsoil finish line. One lap to go for the Pelican Rapids, Minnesota native. The greatest racer of his generation is just half a lap away from another win. There's Peter Narsa, who is second place right now. A good, good run for Peter Narsa. And Lakin Lemieux on tap for third right now, if he can hang on to that spot. Headed for the Air Force flyaway for the final time. Tucker Hibbert on the 68 with a big lead over Peter Narsa. He'll make his way around another lapper into the back section of the racetrack for the final time. Makes that hard left-hand turn. Two turns away from victory is Tucker Hibbert.
Boy, making it look so easy right now. This is just like a practice lap for him. He's not pushing it, not trying anything new. Knows where he wants to go, puts that sled where he wants it.
The flames in the air once again for the T-Train. Tucker Hibbert, who takes another win at Canterbury Park here in round six, the Pertec Snocross Nationals. We'll come back and talk to Tucker Hibbert about how he did it again here at Canterbury after a short break. This is the best show on the snow. It's Amsoil Championship Snowcross powered by Ram on the CBS Sports Network. And we are racing at Shakopee. 15 slams into the turn. Tucker looks to the inside of Lincoln Lemieux. It's a hard move for Tucker, and he takes the spot. Tucker Hibbert up to third spot from the back row.
Tucker having a problem there,
no,
but
he just cased it hard, and it didn't slow him down a bit. Wow, Tucker Hibbert, a strong move and into second of the T-Train. But here comes Peter Narsa. Flames in the air once again for the T-Train. Tucker Hibbert, who takes another win at Canterbury Park here in round six.
Congratulations, Tucker Hibbert. Another incredible race by you. You had to come out of that from the back row. What a tough, challenging race for you.
Yeah, it's not easy coming from the back row. It was a tough second round for me with a big crash, and won the LCQ and just, you know, tried to focus on not doing anything stupid. The track was really challenging. As we could see, it got Cody. You just had to be careful, and I just wanted to get through this race safe. I was okay with second place. I was okay with letting Cody win that one. I didn't want to push myself to the point where I crashed, and I just wanted to finish the race and get home in one piece. And, you know, fortunately for me, unfortunately for Cody, he threw the race away, and I got double wins here in Canterbury. I'm happy, really happy.
How do you weigh those risks out there? Because you have to take the risk sometimes to get up on the podium, but you, like you said, you want to stay safe.
Charging and charging, and it worked out. You know, I got to give it up to my team, Monster Energy, Articat, Ram Truck, Articwear, Speedworks, Fox Shocks, Stud Boy. You know, everyone is behind me 100%. Hot Stuff Pizza. It's been a long weekend. I'm really happy with the results. I got to thank God for blessing me and giving me such a great opportunity and helping me to keep my strength and focus and bring home these wins. And thanks to the fans.
Congrats on the first. Guys, back to you.
Well, there you have it. Another big win for Tucker Hibbert at Canterbury Park. Well, Mike, you just never know what's going to happen. Tucker Hibbert comes away with the win.
Sometimes being lucky is what you need to win in this racing, and that's what happened to Tucker Hibbert. He takes the win, Narsa in second, on the podium both nights in round five and six, and Lincoln Lemieux, a nice showing, putting him on third place on the podium.
So we leave round six with the points looking like this.
Hibbert out in front is just consistent and steady. That's what he always is. Some of these guys are going to really have to step up. We're almost halfway through the season.
We are, and that means we're going to Deadwood, South Dakota. Our next race, the U.S. Air Force Deadwood Snowcross. Then we take off for Seneca Allegheny Resort and Casino in Salamanca, New York. After that, February 26th and 22nd. 26th and 27th, Mount Pleasant, Michigan, March 4th and 5th in Chicago, and we wrap it all up at the Nielsen Snowcross Grand Finale, March 18th through 20th. You want to keep up with us? Of course you do. Facebook.com/ISOCACSS, Twitter.com/Snowcross, Instagram.com/ISOC Racing, and finally, YouTube.com/RaceISOC. For scores, highlights, features, and more, check out CBSSports.com. For Carly Applin, Mike Schroeder, and a cast of thousands, thanks for tuning in. My name is Chris Hockey. You've been watching Amsoil Championship Snowcross powered by Ram on the CBS Sports Network.